Greetings, darklings, from across the interweb. It is once again I, the Duchess Precious Ken, here for the Sounds and Shadows podcast. I got a big one today. This is really exciting. Before we get to that, I wanted to give one shout out to Armalite Records, who sent me this awesome hoodie, which I was planning to show off and wear here. And I think a lot of people can relate to this, that Rachel saw a wonderful fuzzy new hoodie and just grabbed that. So I won't get to show it, but I will give a shout out to Jules from Armalite, the producer there. It is his birthday today. So happy birthday, Jules. The other thing I want to say quickly is this weekend, I'm really geeked. I'm going to Athens, Georgia to see our good friends Twin Tribes and to meet Vision Video, Dusty in person finally. So I'm really excited for that. Tears for the Dying, Adria is going to be playing too. It's going to be amazing. Great show. Really excited for it. Now, without further ado, I have with me a huge influence on the scene for many years now, and someone I'm just really excited to talk to, Ronan Harris of VNV Nation. Welcome to the show.
Hello. Hi.
So I'm excited to talk to you. I got a lot of ground to cover here, but one thing I always like to start off with in the interview is there was a thing, whether it was a show, a record you bought, I don't know, you saw Blade Runner and it flicked a light in your head or something, but what was that thing that made you say, this is me, this scene and this music is what I want to do, that you feel really kind of brought you in and started you on the path of this type of music?
All right. I kind of inadvertently got embraced by what you refer to in North America as the scene. It's a term that Europeans, they've got like the dark scene. They've got all these different sort of like versions of scene and what have you. But I was always interested in electronic music, even as a child, and it somehow connected with me. I'm no spring chicken, so I was born at a time where during the 70s, even as a kid, I would hear all kinds of crazy electronic music on the radio. And I love tuning through shortwave and making sounds, even by turning the dial and trying to make rhythms with it, which almost sounds like industrial. It just evolved. I mean, I went through the period in the late 70s of starting to buy records, and I was buying anything with a synthesizer if I could. I mean, I had minimum amounts of money. So I was looking through bargain bins to get anything. And the great thing was I picked up a Tonto's Expanding Headband album and a Tangerine Dream album and all these things that were being sold for like pennies. And I just started listening to things. And my dad had bought me, he tried to buy me the Kraftwerk single for Autobahn because it was in the charts and I loved the song. It was like one of those things, you know, as a kid where you hear a happy melody and you think, I love this. And he tried to buy it for me for my birthday. And they told him in the shop that it was all sold out. And he reluctantly bought me the album. So I got to hear Kraftwerk's Autobahn album at a very tender age and played on a little suitcase record player. So that was my advent with electronic music. And then from that, I mean, you know, the late 70s, things were congealing. I was blessed to be living in Ireland, which is obviously next to the UK, where electronic music was exploding. And I suppose like forming into something bigger and better than what had already happened with it, which was electro disco, you know, this kind of Donna Summer's I Feel Love track or anything like that. But we got to hear all of that. I got to hear a lot of electronic music on the radio. For some reason, Irish radio loved playing electronic music between shows as links to the next show. My first synthesizer, I think, is where I kind of realized, you know, I can actually do this. Like, this isn't just some weird fantasy. Or my friend got a ZX81. His dad was a major player at a big computer company and got his kid a Sinclair ZX81 with these membrane switches on it. So we spent, other people got BMX bikes. We all spent every day over there programming Space Invaders. thinking this is going to save us the whatever it costs. I can't even remember what Space Invaders cost, but I remember there was only one arcade machine I knew about. And that was kind of like everything just, I grew up in the right time for it all to gel. And, you know, through the 80s, you've got everything from listening to melodic synthesizer music to listening to underground stuff. And I was always, there was always this duality in me that I would be listening to experimental stuff because that had been very much a part of my growing up. It was part of soundtracks of sci-fi shows or movies. And the British were really into dystopia and they really went all out with very, very harrowing and spooky sounding electronics. I mean, we grew up with, you know, Quatermass or Doctor Who and things like that. And I mean, the Doctor Who theme was probably the original. It was just the soundtrack to Forbidden Planet. These were things I remember from my childhood. They would end up on TV and I just gravitated towards stuff like that. So on one side, I listened to melodic stuff. I listen to a wide variety of music. I always have. I've never restricted myself to any one genre. And on the other side, I'm listening to constructivist, avant-garde and what have you, and weirdness. So there you go. There was no one moment, but it just seemed to evolve. And that's kind of leading me up to where I am now.
That's great. And I think that goes really well with where I want to go next. And my question is, when I think of the music that you've done, and I mean, spanning decades on it, you're more towards the side of the Bowie spectrum than the Stones spectrum for me, in the sense that the Stones make great music and I enjoy a good Stones record, but a lot of it has been fundamentally the same for the majority of their career. That it's rock music.
Okay. Whereas, that's an interesting analogy. That is a very interesting analogy. Okay.
Whereas Bowie has reinvented himself, you know, six or seven times.
I know, you're right.
A totally different genre.
I went through that whole kind of like Liaison John Giroux's image. And then the next I was like, oh, no, I haven't really changed. My image has been more, I understand what you mean. My image has been more like dictated by genetics than anything, but musically, I think there's a
musically
common...
you've changed a lot. So I guess my question is, and what I'd love to hear as someone who has, I feel like done that, like not just been making different genres, but kind of the cutting edge of a few, you know, different, I don't know, new styles in music or new waves in it. How do you feel for maybe bands trying now and trying to have that kind of longevity? What do you think played into you being able to take your fans who enjoyed your music when you did this, and then you evolved, did something totally different, and still brought them with you because it still resonated with them, even though the sound was different?
I've always said, like, I mean, when I ask people what it was that brought them, that connected with them, that brought them, say, from Praise the Fallen into Empires, to Future Perfect, to Matter and Form, to Judgment, to God knows what. The message, the emotion, that it evolved with them and evolved with their life, that it wasn't stagnant, which I think plagued a lot of bands. I'm not going to call them one-trick ponies, but there were a few who just wanted to be bands. And I think that was the thing that separated those who continued on in a music career and those who basically lasted a couple of albums and it just became a tired repetition. I'm not here to sully the names of anybody or comment on anybody. I'll comment on myself, but as an observer, I really found that those people who didn't connect with or didn't go on with the albums were listening to the music like it was an accessory. And I've never been one for being an accoutrement. So, if you like it, I really don't make albums thinking, oh, this will be exactly what people want to hear. I make what drives me. And I think the common thing that I've heard from other artists outside of this genre, which is mostly where my musical tastes live, is do it with passion. Do it for yourself and do it with heart and soul, because that radiates out of music. It is an almost indistinguishable quality that people can't discern, can't describe. It's a quintessential element, and that resonates with a great deal of people. But the spiritualism, if you want to call it that, or the poetry in the lyrics, something, the fact that every album has its own form of, say, cinematic flair, if whatever film that may be or book, has dragged people along, and they've garnered something really wonderful out of it. In some cases, it wasn't always successful. There were people who were very resistant to albums in Europe, where sort of the mainstay of this genre, so to speak, was. And they were very resistant to changes. And I said, well, you just stuck on a sound you really liked, and that's not what I'm here for. I'm really not into that. And I'm sorry if we didn't understand each other, but this music is going to keep evolving with my tastes. The most important thing, and this surprised people, we did an analysis once in an interview where we took apart an album. And I talked about where all the influences came from, or where I can clearly identify the influences came from. And I think I kind of gave the person some form of culture shock, because they were hoping to hear all these familiar names that are sort of bridged in or walled into something of a proto-industrial kind of cultural thing. And I said, in the 80s, there was nothing until it kind of gelled somewhere in the late 80s. Everything was sporadic. Even Nitzer Ebb's That Total Age for me was like retro, because I'd like DAF, like 1980, 81. I kind of wondered like why 5-6 years later there's a band doing the same thing. So there was no one movement in the 80s. It was people coming back from the US with albums by Keith LeBlanc and listening to Tackhead or listening to all these kinds of disparate sort of sounds that seemed to somehow gel into something. But I didn't really have that feeling that it was anything more than it was a form of industrial dance music. And even the word industrial for us was off grounds, because that meant Neubauten. We just called it like, we had lots of names for it, like hard electronic music. You know, we didn't really know what to call it. It's a really weird thing. But for me, even in the 80s, everybody, you listened to everyone, you looked at everyone's listening taste, because there were so few bands around. People, in any case, were listening to a massive variety of music. And then sometime in the 90s, it kind of crossed over with all the goth nights. Right. Which I thought was interesting. And then you have two communities, if you want to call them that, to use a popular term, crossing over in the same space, criticizing each other for the way they look. And so the goth rivet head thing, as you call it here, kind of progressed. But it was an amazing cross-pollination, because the one thing about gothic music that was, at least the listening, the range of bands they would listen to, they wrote songs. They wrote passionate melodies. We'd all grown up with things like 4AD bands. I mean, I was a massive Cocteau Twins fan in the 80s, as well as listening to really crazy, hard-edged, like unlistenable stuff. I listened to Cabaret Voltaire as much as I listened to the Blue Nile, which is a melancholic pop band from the era. They all somehow became part of a large palette that you drew from to reflect your emotions. It was quite a wild ride in the 80s. There was so much to listen to. It was a very different place in Europe than it was here. I can guarantee you that.
Sure. No, I love some of the points that you made there. And that's like when we do our chart for Sounds and Shadows, I call it the dark scene singles chart, for just that reason, because I got so sick of everybody trying to explain what was or wasn't goth or industrial. And I just said, you know what? It's fractured so much, who even cares at this point? Like,
well, it was fractured in the 90s. There used to be like, when I first got involved with the internet, because I used to work in, I worked in IT. I started out as a sort of systems designer, systems programmer. And that was in the late 80s. That was my career. That's what I'd studied for. I managed to get a really interesting program that earned me a degree. So I was, I'd moved to Toronto by that stage, and it was my first chance to use dial-up internet. And this is like 1990, right? And I just ran into someone at a bar who said, yeah, you know, I run this little BBS. And I said, eh? And they explained how they hook it up. And I said, oh, right, it's all part of this topology, blah, blah, blah. And they went, yeah, you can get dial-up internet here. And if you had seen the Usenet groups of the time, which are like, you know, forums.
I used to run a BBS.
Right. So you know how the whole, like, the forums work, and you have subpages and what have you. And they still exist. They're quaint, antiquated. Maybe they will outlast AI. Who knows? Because they'll be kind of like, for nerds, they'll understand the reference of that the Battlestar Galactica was so out of date that it was the perfect defense against the Cylons because they couldn't actually adapt to the systems. They were so antiquated.
And hey, Trade Wars is still a fun game to this day.
Yeah. Oh, my God, yeah. But the thing is, it's like it's going to be like that. Like BBSs and Usenet are probably going to outlast AI because they'll be so antiquated that AI won't even be able to know, like what's a flame war? But I met people on there back in 1990 who I still know, who were like 12 at the time writing. And it was always the same things. Everyone was arguing. And you started to see this is what the internet will become. It's just an endless stream of some people who are acting as know-alls, being very, very patronizing. Some people who just want to know information and share their passion. Some people who just want to open up a door into a Usenet group and throw in a grenade and leave. Yeah, that's where we were going. I think we already saw that in 1990. But fragmented it was then. I can't understand people who need to reduce everything down to a specific description, because that really depends on the maturity of their listening experience. It's an incredibly subjective and detailed thing.
It is. I would say on this show that really the only thing to me genre is good for is as a music reviewer saying, if you like thing A, you might like thing B.
Yep.
And that's about where it ends for me.
Absolutely. I mean, from a distance, there's people who can't tell any of this stuff apart. They think that it amazed me when someone said, oh, you sound like the Prodigy. And it was because they don't listen to anything relevant that would give them any education or any, just the terms to be able to describe it. It was incomprehensible to them. So, I mean, to someone who listens to black metal all day, Depeche Mode and VNV probably sound identical. I don't know.
Sure. If there's no spectrum for it to go on.
You don't have reference points. I mean, in the 80s or in the 90s, we're all trying to make our way. God, I'm making myself sound so terribly old.
So another thing that I love that you said, and I would say if I was kind of describing in your music to the answer to my own question, what I think helps in that is I think a lot of the production value and the fact that music labels, are different these days. And I think there's some positives to new music and positive things that I love about it. But one of the things I would say maybe to the people who always want to hold up the past or the history that I think really was maybe better back in the day is the emphasis on lyrics and narrative and story. And I think that's something that your music, one of the reasons it has resonated and been powerful, regardless of the sound of the particular album as you've gone on, is, as you said, you have, to me, really interesting ideas and almost like a movie that goes with every album, to the point where, as somebody who's 46 and, you know, still writing music and trying, the sheer volume of kind of ideas and stories that you've put into the songs seems like a lot. Do you continue to find inspiration as you go?
I knew you were going to ask this. During the pandemic alone, I was trying to build a studio. We got back from this weekend, we're going to be playing Guadalajara. And then Tuesday next, we're playing in Mexico City. Mexico City was our last gig before the pandemic shutdown. We flew back to Europe and everybody was screaming. Everyone's in a panic. There are sirens in the distance. People are running. There are planes falling from the sky. We all remember how terrible it was. It wasn't. It was just basically the government on the radio saying, everybody stay home. But that was our last gig before all that. So we're closing the circle. When I went back, I'd already started building a studio and I just had the frame walls. So stud walls, wooden framework all over. And it was this painful process of 2 years of trying to get every company in to do their job because nobody could schedule anything anymore. So what happened was during the time when I resolved myself to, okay, I can be frustrated by things I can't control. That's not something I like to do. So took a breath, sat back and said, right, what can I do? And when I'm doing things that don't have anything to do with music, songs pop into my head. It's as if there's a part of my brain that just gets bored and just like starts whistling. I have a system for writing those down. I have a synthesizer on my phone with my fat fingers. I record screen, I record the screen and me playing it. Or I whistle into the phone or I sing into the phone. I sing some lyrics, some snatches and bits and pieces and whatever. I didn't stop writing. And then I get to my laptop up in the office, which at least, not acoustically treated, but it's in my office in the building. And, because I run the label, I run the bands and all this kind of stuff. I've got to have some kind of place where I can do all the accounts and all that fun stuff. So I have my little speakers there and keyboard. And to be honest, it's the minimalism and the simplicity of it that brought out some of the best ideas. And I was constantly writing these things into the computer. During the pandemic, I wrote 83 songs. That's how many songs I had. And I'm not saying when is the future? I'll give you an example of that. That was like me in the last week of writing the album or 2 weeks, something like that. So 2 or 3 weeks before finishing the album. I was sitting there one night going through directories of old melody snippets going back, and there was one from a 2006 2007 which was the bass chords, some strings, and it had the it had a lot of the harmonies already in it but played on different sounds. It was just a little idea thrown together, and the vocal melody, and that's what a lot of my basic ideas are, because if you're using demo sounds, so you want to use as simplistic a sound as possible so it doesn't tarnish or lead you into a position that when you start working on a song in the studio, you can't get that sound out of your head. So you want to leave it as naked as possible. It's like writing a song on a piano or an acoustic guitar. Did that. So I had about 83 of these and I had to run it down to the album. But the... Oh, bye.
I'm still with you, but elderly cat decided it was time to go and she would have thrown a fit in here if I didn't let her out. Okay.
No, don't worry. You take care of Kitty. It's that's all good. All good. I can't stop writing songs. I can't stop writing music. I listen to so much music that just ideas, even inspired by the sound I've been listening to, like they've all been synthesized together, get written. I've written so many songs in so many other genres that it just astonishes me. I don't know what to do with them. I've got albums worth, but I definitely wrote about 2 to 3 albums worth of material. And I reduce it down to the ones that I wanted to use for Electric Sun. And here's the problem. You reduce it down to, say, 14, 15 songs. You go, those will gel. Those will work. And then you end up writing 4 more during the production of the album, like I did with When Is the Future. Well, you end up with this perpetual list of songs that never get written. Chrome was one of those. Chrome was one of these, like, ideas I'd written in 2000. It was just, like, the sound. This kind of thing. And a bass drum. And there was just this pulsing little 8-note bass line going along with it. It was just a little snippet, like, wouldn't this be a great basis for a track? And it's that raw material at that right moment, gets into your head, and suddenly a song is written within about, 4 hours. It's easy.
You're talking about the music on that, but what about in terms of the lyrics and the ideas for the song? Is it a lot the same way? Or do you see something, that just pops an idea in your head and you get an idea for a story? Or
When Is the Future was purely based on, well, I'm thinking about the song. I remember a moment being, I used to have this really high flying job before I quit, to do VNV full time. And at one point I had to fly to Southeast Asia. And I was at a meeting and I asked somebody, where do people go on the weekend? And there really wasn't a weekend as we understand it, because they, do different days. And I said, I just want to go to a local area. I don't want to go where the tourists go. I don't want to go where the big flash hotels are. In fact, I hate that. So I want to go where the locals are. And there was a street with where the power cables on the street were just like slapped on top of one another. There's neon all over, neon on top of neon, old shops repurposed. Everything was just this organic layer of everything. And at one street corner, there'd be like 10 people on motorcycles or little simple motorbikes, whatever, hanging out. And then somewhere else, there'd be something else. And there was all types of people in windows and all kinds of stuff going on. And I've never seen so much life. And that was the kind of image I had writing When Is the Future. It just kind of went boom, because it was this whole idea for me about noir had a concept. And that concept, before I start the album, will influence every single song. So with When Is the Future, it was to question, well, we were all promised jetpacks once. We were all promised that everything could be better. So how is it we keep managing to make, with all these great new inventions we've got, and we keep talking about everything. And then we go, no, we don't need any of that anymore. We need something new. Let's create a whole new ideal for the future. It's like, we haven't even put this one in place yet. And we're already talking about changing the game plan. And it's just this perpetual, inescapable feeling that the future is always out of reach. And it's always much worse than we ever hoped it would be. It's never going to be as shiny and sunny. And the irony was that when I went to Tokyo to do the video, nobody could have predicted this. We went to Tokyo because the film director said, well, if you want to talk about future, why don't we go to a futuristic city? It was raining in Tokyo. It was raining bad. All the clouds were hanging really low. And I'm standing in, I think we were in at Shinjuku Station. We were at one side of it, and everyone's coming out in their clear plastic umbrellas, everyone dressed identically, going home from work in the dark. Neon everywhere, but there's a building right next to me stretching off into the sky with this gigantic LED wall on it, advertising a new edition of Final Fantasy. In the clouds. I mean, there's sounds coming out. Everything beeps. Everything. It's crazy. It's like if you're the first time you visit, it's amazing. It's endearing. I'm sure it'll annoy the piss out of anybody. But every store has got little voices coming out of it, little anime voices that are there to trigger your interest or whatever. I seriously stood in Blade Runner. Like that's, you're kind of thinking about there's a slight dystopian kind of sarcasm to the track, but it's about how wonderful everything could be. In a way, or at least our aspirations. I'm not saying how wonderful everything that in and of itself is ridiculous, because it reduces or it negates the human element. We could have what we want. We could have enough that would make us happy. We'd all sit around and go, you happy, happy? Everyone got everything? Yeah, we good? Okay, let's start from here. And it was
could be Star Trek, but everybody, it seems, wants to be Biff Tannen from Back to the Future, where it seems pettier. But you're right, like it seems like going towards a higher aspiration or hope gets lost along the way, even when we think of our own science fiction.
We built 80s dystopia, we built the dark future. That's what we've got. Congratulations, everybody. Yeah, right. Okay. Set directors. All right. Now, but as far as writing songs, I've never had a problem. I do. There are times when I struggle and I feel like I'm pulling a thread too hard and I feel that's convoluted. So I stop. I step back and I rethink it until it's a feeling. It's like it's almost like there are smatterings of words that are there, like as if someone has written something on a wall, carved it, and only some of the letters are starting to appear. And it's a very abstract process. And then suddenly it all starts to fit together, but it always makes sense in that it is about the subject that I had intended to write about. Electric Sun was easiest so far. That was the one that really frightened me. Not frightened me, but it was like, why couldn't it have been like this before? I would stand in front of the microphone, close my eyes, and the studio didn't exist. There was no pressure. This is the best part about, say, having a laptop or a computer in another room where you're just working on your music. You're not sitting in front of speakers saying, all right, make it. Come on. There's none of this sort of person behind you, this expectation or any of that. you're in the right mode. You're making it for the right reasons. So I stood in front of the microphone and I sang like I've never sung. It was the song Run, even Electric Sun itself. There are takes of that song where I'm just wondering, what am I channeling? It floored me, really. But then I go and listen to, say, something like Automatic, and listen to Space and Time, and it's like, is that the same person? It's really weird for me sometimes, but there was a vibe. It was pulling something out of me. I'd listened to a lot of 50s and 60s music during the pandemic, and I'm sure a lot of that had a really interesting influence on it. It didn't feel unnatural. I mean, every song fit into the theme. Every song connected together. Every song fell into place as though it were part of a soundtrack to a film that hadn't been made.
I love that. And actually, I can relate. I really can. Like, I think, you know, in my own process, like, I do. I hear what you're saying there. Another thing I wanted, that you touched on a little bit, that I wanted to ask about is, again, I call, you know, our page, we write the dark scene genre reviews. But I've always kind of thought of you outside of that. Because one of the things about your music that I think is a thread through a lot of it is, for being often dystopian or talking about, it's often very hopeful too. Your music has a lot of hope and inspiration in the songs. Maybe not every track on the album, but that's sure. Always present to me and there, that there are these songs that are saying, yes, like the world is a fucked up, dark place, but there is something to shoot for.
I avoid in almost all cases, I avoid referencing this world. Sure. I avoid politics. I avoid current situations, which will be dated in 2 years. Yesterday's news is yesterday's news. It's forgotten. It's replaced with something else.
But I was more speaking to, like, ideas or narratives, like you said, where you have a lot of this, to me, optimism or hope in a lot of your songs. And I was kind of curious as to, for coming up here, for this last album and the one coming out, and the whatever current situation in all over the place, or ideas of what's happened to humanity right now, what are maybe some of the things that you think on this album are going to be your hope, or your thing that you want to try and strive for challenging times, just like always?
Well, the hope is, like, it's a personal message of personal growth. I regard most of what's happening on the planet right now as incredibly irrelevant over the great span of time. I learned something from a very, very wise spiritual teacher. I love meeting people like that, because somebody told me something back in London in 1987, which changed my life. It was just a simple sentence, and it was about everybody is your teacher. And it was that was the gist of it. And I kind of looked funny and I thought about it. And that sort of led me on a greater path. I've always sought knowledge. I've always looked for greater wisdoms. But the world in the 80s was screwed up. World in the 90s was screwed up. World in 2000s was screwed up. 2010s, it was screwed up. It's no less screwed up now. We're back to 1973. History's just doing it's basically like, you know, when you watch a TV show and you think, oh, you just rehashed a plot. That's what they're doing now. Mm-hmm. Let's throw in some AI for some spookiness, you know, kind of, ooh, will we be able to cut the green wire with
two? Oh, edgy. Right.
Yeah, it's always like, I mean, over here, there's a friend of mine who says, if I hear another last minute save on another government shutdown, and I'm like sitting over in Europe reading the news going, oh, another? Really? And it's always going to be, oh, at the very last second. Da-na-na-na. And it's the same thing over and over again. It's like, seriously, it's turning into Days of Our Lives. Will they come out of a coma? Oh my God, no, tune in next week. It's just getting ridiculous. It's almost like laughable. It's like, is this all staged? Anyway, there's a couple of people out there who just heard what I said and went, yeah, Harris, it is. You should watch this YouTube.
Honestly, it legit. I think it is pretty much like WWF wrestling at this point, our politics is. But yeah.
I didn't want to say.
Well, I'll say it. I'll be the first to say it. You know, we're all playing golf with each other with your money. And honestly, they don't hate each other nearly as much as they will pretend on TV.
It's the same thing about anything. I mean, people just love the drama and they love to be people are being riled up by YouTube and TikTok and various other media sites which run algorithms where you watch little shorts and suddenly you start seeing things enter your feed as if they're there to try to rile you up. And anyway, so meanwhile, back at the plot, the message has, like, take a song like Chrome. It's about the evolution of a personality, the evolution to sort of a higher level of existence within one's life, because one does need to progress. One does need to mature to make a transformation into another stage of life. And it's something that's intrinsically built in. I was surrounded by people who were Peter Pans. They always wanted to stay, you know, 18 forever, and couldn't understand why at the age of 40 they were bitter. They're still wearing the same shirts, and they become the Simon Pegg character out of The World's End, you know, someone who can't move on from something. Yeah. And I mean, that metaphor exists in so many great folk tales. It's like the inability to move on, that stumbling block, that whatever it is that is blocking your way, that must be overcome. So a lot of what I talk about is there are allusions to very sort of, I guess, a process of development of the person, that every day try to be a better person than you were yesterday. And it's not some hippy dippy kind of thing. It's like, it's more of a self-actualization, self-betterment thing. And I've been studying this for years through various people and just collecting bits of information. What's your perspective? What's yours? We'll sit on a bus and suddenly find, like, when we're on a tour, and suddenly find a lot of people want to talk about this. And everyone's sharing their perspectives on what it is to kind of, nobody's got a manual. We're sitting in this, we're born into existence being told these are the rules. And you're like, okay. It's a weird old existence. So, like, we're trying to make our way, trying to make it better for ourselves. But at the same time, I'm talking about the individual. Adversity is the best way to learn. Every obstacle is a way to learn. It is a way to learn something about yourself. And yes, if you do lose, or if you do fail, or you think you fail, you didn't, you just learn something, you go away. It's like a video game, for God's sakes. You try the level. If you can't get past the whatever fella you're going to meet, whatever boss, sub boss, big demon, whatever, you come back and you try it again until you overcome it. It's the exact same principle paralleled through everything in nature, but this one is specifically about, like, self-actualization. And really out of experience, that I wrote albums for myself at times to give myself an artificial light, to guide myself, to inspire myself, because I wasn't hearing that from others, because I was the person that everybody came to for advice. I was the one they all came to, like, oh, she doesn't like me, or he doesn't like me, or what do I do? And it's like, oh, petty little problems that here we are. How many years later, since, you know, this is like around the time of Empires, and I'm just sitting there, does any of it matter? Did any of it, was it relevant outside of the time? So please think long term. Think about where you want to be and how you want to be. It's not about wealth. It's not about possessions or any of those fun things. It's really just about the gold and the sort of strength within oneself. And that's just a recurring theme. But there are levels to what I write. And there are references to things which are just schools of thought. There's references to Gnosticism. There's they're all over. And I get people walking up to me who really read about this stuff, and they're going, okay, are you talking about, and they start mentioning and citing all these books, and I go, whoa, don't overcomplicate it, don't make it all kind of like secret spooky stuff. It's really simple and it's accessible to everyone. It is not an elite school of, you know, hierarchies or whatever else, some hidden mystery school. Every single person has the answers, and it's just a matter of kind of nudging them. I had somebody say to me at a concert recently, thank you, you saved my life because we played Illusion. And I said, I didn't save your life and don't ever say that to me. And I was quite, it probably sounded quite harsh when I said it, but yeah. I said, don't ever tell me that I saved you. And under no circumstances. And this person was looking at me kind of like a little bit confused. And I said, you saved you. No one else. I didn't walk in and kind of like grab something out of your hand or kind of like jump in front of you as the bullet flew towards you or something like that.
Yeah.
You had the strength. All you needed was that moment where everything clicked. And at that right moment, it clicked. And maybe a song put you in that place. And I said, but you wanted to hear that song. Someone plays Funky Cold Medina to me. I do not actually want to listen to it. I literally, my brain will make a choice going, please take this device emanating this horrible piece of rubbish, throw it out the window. I don't like a lot of crap, right? So your brain physically gravitates towards something. It will lock onto something it needs. It'll either hear a sad song and go, oh my God, this describes everything in my life right now. It's a reflection of you. It's what your brain wants to feed on. And if that happens to be the song Illusion at that right time, it is very much about that process. I had more emails. Kids don't write emails. You can't imagine how many teens wrote to me. Grown women, like women sure. in the 50s, 60s, who wanted to, just didn't want to go on, and wrote about what that song had done, how it had affected them. That's a quite a crazy responsibility to have. And
that's
one of the things that started. I take it as a great compliment, but I also feel a sense of responsibility. I'm very calm and very quiet with people about it. I write what I can, what I can say. I don't want to say it.
No, but that's kind of, to me, the crux of what you're driving at is that you have this impact. And when you're talking about self-reflection and growth, it's about being able to take a statement like that and saying, thank you. I'm proud that I said something you related to that meant to you. But at the same time, having the self-actualization to know, this isn't me. This person did it on their own. This person did it themselves. And I feel good that I put something in the world that helped make that happen. But at the same time, we're all responsible for ourselves. And you don't sit around curled up in a ball worrying about every song you made and how people take it.
We are and we aren't responsible for ourselves. I mean, I think it's very Ayn Rand to say that everyone is responsible for themselves. I think we don't exist as islands. We are not isolated from one another. It's not like you're walking along in a long march and if someone falls down to the ground, you just ignore them and go, yeah, tough shit. That's kind of more cruel nature than one we've evolved into, which is what we have. We have compassion. Animals have compassion. We know this. There are lots of examples of this. What I mean is it's important to tell someone that they had that strength, that this was not some power from without. I don't ever want someone to look up and kind of go, you saved me. That doesn't happen. You don't do that with me. No one saved me. I used to think that someone did, but I kind of came to the point that I just had the tools I needed at the right time to put my brain in the right place. If anybody wants to know how that works, watch the movie Wings of Desire. It's a beautiful metaphor of the process. It's my favorite film of all time. I saw it by accident in, I think it was 1991. So it would be about a year after it had been made. It is the most incredible document of East West Berlin at the time. But this whole metaphor with Bruno Ganz as one of the angels and these two angels sitting in this car dealership, right, where nobody can see them, comparing notes of things, innocent things they've seen in life. And it's how they inspire and how they fight for the inspiration of people. It's just a metaphor. Oh, and Nick Cave does a cameo, which is amazing. And Peter Falk.
I mean, that's the... Well,
and he plays
one of my favorites.
He plays an ex-angel. He's like an ex-angel in the movie. He's just genius. However,
I don't want to talk about the Nicolas Cage version later on. I don't acknowledge it either.
Breaking up. Sorry, I can't hear you. Oh God, almighty.
All right, hold on. We're getting up near the end now, and I want to change gears a little. We're going to lighten up a little now, and some of my listeners and viewers, you know, a lot of them are musicians themselves. And although I'm not a gear nerd, a lot of them are. And so tell me about, for this last album, I know you said a lot of it is you just on your phone when you're writing or whatnot.
No, that's just writing melodies.
Right. But one new toy that you used for the new record, I know, that you really felt like added something fresh and new to this sound that maybe you hadn't had or used before.
Okay. I'm saying this in a lot of interviews. I am sick to death of painting with one finger. I am sick and tired of trying to use a mouse to control equipment for which was developed for a tactile experience for people who were lucky to have two hands and 10 fingers, right? I loved in the past being able to mess with a piece of gear and hit buttons and whatever. Fisher-Price way of learning, right? But knowing what I'm doing, I can change things on the fly. I can get my answers really fast as my brain is thinking. But on a computer, I'm just getting sick of drag that window over there. Okay, I'd like to change this little control here. And now it's... honestly, it's like I can't move at that speed. This is not what we were built for. We were not built with a single proboscis, so to speak. The analogy I always use is painting a house, the hallway of a house, through the letterbox. So I got tired of that. I mean, people go, yeah, you need MIDI controllers, man. Like, okay, I just pulled out some really crazy synthesizers. I've got a mad collection. I've been collecting since I kind of started buying synths. I just took out some key elements. I knew what I wanted to sound, what I went for. I had the 3 years during the whole pandemic thing to build the studio into the best it could be. So I have everything I need when I need it, but also the system that I can bring gear in and out and it never clutters the room. One side, I've got all my outboard gear, all my, my rack of compressors, EQs and whatever, but they are all specialized in that. Every one of them does a special thing. And anyone who tells me as a kid of my, my age group that, nah, man, you can do it all with the computer. It's like, yeah, if you want to recall things, but I can literally prove to you that that is not the case. And there's a lot of reasons. It's really, people don't know how to use a lot of the gear that they use. And I'm not going to get into this because there's a lot of people who would come back at me and go, yeah, but what about this? And I don't want your comment thread to be a flame war, but I've got all my bits and pieces. I've got I'm really lucky to have a stereo pull tech if gear nerds know what that is. And I combine that together with a Chandler Zener limiter, which is a pricey thing. But when you want a certain sound, I've made the difference a long time ago of instead of buying lots of crappy gear, saving my money and buying one good piece at a time so I could build it up. So I've got this thing does the most astonishing things with vocals. This thing does, which is an organic acoustic thing. I can use a plugin on it, but believe me, I've never heard a plugin do what some of this gear does because, not going to get into electroacoustics, not going to get into any of that. So, I've got that. On the other side, I've got my idea engine of all these different synths. There was one synth which, I bought a Sequential Pro 1 back, a long, long, long time ago. And I liked the sound. It was pretty much the bass lines on Empires and Praise the Fallen and Advance and Follow even. And it had done a lot of sounds. It's just been responsible for so much. I had a limited amount of gear and I used it for all three of those albums. That's amazing, considering all three of those albums sound so different. So that's a good thing. Anyway, one of my friends, Julio, who booked our very first show in San Francisco, he works at Sequential. And I went over to visit him when we were in San Francisco, tried out one of his synths. And I was like, oh, okay, I think I might get back into Sequential. You've got some nice ideas. And I bought their Pro 3. I said to my partner, babe, I'm just going to put the synth, I'm just going to turn it on, put the headphones on, just going to listen to some patches because it just arrived and it's a really sweet piece of gear. I know you understand, honey, and you got me and, whatever. And I said, I'll be in a half an hour. 5.5 hours later, I came to bed and I had programmed about 3 banks of sounds. And that's when I kind of went, and this is months before I started the production. I was like, It's that twiddling and knowing how far things go. And in my head, I'm visualizing it is a, an interface to your ideas. Yeah. But the sound you could, what you can get it to do through that. I had a couple of really, really cool pieces of gear that I was using on this. I have a 500 rack, which is like small versions of studio gear. That's really expensive. That's usually very empty with a power supply and a couple of bits of circuitry, but they sell for vast amounts of money. And a company called API went, hey, why don't we make it smaller and you stop ripping off people? And they made all these small pieces of gear, which are really, really cool. And there's a couple of things in there which really did some amazing things, just being able to place elements within the mix. Some really, really nice like EQs for when I needed them, like Harrison EQs. I even used the stretch module. If people know what that is, it's a game changer to me because I haven't found a plugin yet that does it. And doing the old, as gear nerds will know, the Dolby effect. And what I wanted to create was this hybrid vibe of like saturation, 70s vibe. I love, there's something about 70s recording, and I know it's all saturation and tape and what have you, but there's something about the, even the way people overdrove, like the way they were overdriven, overdrove their guitars. And they just had this like lovely harmonics on the top. And it's what always gets me. If you listen to the guitar, say on Black Sabbath, Paranoid, that's what I mean. It's just, there are so many levels of harmonics on it. Little things like that, or say some Pink Floyd recordings, even going back to some of the like the weird stuff from like late 60s, early 70s, where people were just distorting anything or just overdriving anything. And I wanted that vibe, that organicness. Every single sound within it was reprocessed. Even plugins were put out through preamps, or put out through the audio interface into preamps back in. It sounds like an incredible amount of labor, and there's probably people out there going, yeah, it's bullshit, who cares? I would say you can hear it at the end, because the dimensions and the levels of things, all the little individual elements, whether it be drums or God knows what, basses, listen to, there's a ton of movement going on in the track Sunflare. And Chris, who drums for us on North American tours, Chris and I have been working together since 2017. He is an exceptional drummer, teaches drumming at a big school. And he was listening through the elements of the song going, there are so many tiny little layers which combine together to give you the impression of a very simplistic piece of music. That's this lovely harmonic up-down melody. He said, but when you start digging deeper on any of the songs, you find all these little elements. That's what I wanted to do. So as far as gear nerds are concerned, I would use beautifully saturated and distorted sounds, and I would just shape them. I mean, I was using, obviously, some of the EQs, the plugins today are fantastic. I use the plugins that work, not just because they're there. Yeah. So I'm using like Fab Filter, I'm using Universal Audio or Soft Tube stuff. I've got a version for laptop which works as much on the road as it does in the studio. Like it'll replicate what I've got with all the, you know, hardware, very Andrew Shep's version of things. If you know who that is, one of my idols. And then I've just basically, I have these great synthesizers. I bought a Novation Peak, which I think is, I classify as the greatest polysynth of all time, because it just has this vibe, like all of the greatest polysynths in one. And I can make it sound sweet, and I can get it to places where I'm just thinking, I'm in love with the sound. I'm living in the sound. But it's a weird amalgam of stuff going back decades. Decades of synths. Like I took out, I'm really lucky. I kind of hold the thing like I'm holding air that's about to break, as if someone said, hey, we have a piece of, hello kitty, how you doing, Ginger?
That's Freya,
really, goddess.
Yeah.
Okay, not because of the Thor movies, you actually were into Norse mythology before all this, right?
It's true. And she an amazing goddess queen. She had an operation and has three legs now because she got cancer in one, and a bunch of musicians stepped up and helped her, and she's doing wonderful now.
That's great.
So, Ronan, I wanted to hit on here, because we have reached the end of our time that you had for it. But there's an, I know. This has been incredible. I hope to have you back. There is five questions that I still had that I didn't get to, but I think it's important. I want to
ask. Do them quick.
Well, the most important one here is, What's the future? What do you have that people need to be excited for, whether it's the tour, the album? Where can people...
I'll answer so we don't use up the time. Sorry, move on.
Do it.
Got a remix album or EP coming out. I had remixes done by some of my favorite artists, electronic artists, some from trance, some from synthwave, some from, you know, other weird genres and stuff like that. I'm working on the arrangements for the next orchestral album, which will all hopefully wind up with luck and a fair wind before we get to the 8 concerts in Germany next May with a full orchestra in Germany. We did a version at Mariluna, which was a more cut down version of 20 string musicians and a classical pianist. I absolutely adore working with the orchestra because I've been mental about classical music and the avant-garde and the romantic era since I was 5. It is very much a part of my music, always has. I think if anyone listens to the new album, they will hear that I really went out and sort of went, you know what, I've been hiding all my love of orchestral arrangements and keeping it nice and keeping it real. So I really went out on this album, and much to the chagrin of some of the guys who play keyboards, wondering like how many chord changes can you have in this bloody song? And they were listening to Invictus, trying to remember the chord pattern, and said, it's like, it's just constant variance. And I said, well, sorry about that, but you know, so it is. I already had worked on a concept for an album, which I had to put in a drawer because, again, I did not want the title, concept, or anything about that album to be tied into what was happening in the world at the time. One thing that really annoyed me about noir was every now and again, I've been saying this over and over, this is what noir is about. And then there were people going, is this about Trump? I'm in Europe. Your problem over there. 4% of the population of the planet can deal with it. You guys, why would I write an album about something like that? It doesn't interest me. It's irrelevant. But there were constantly people who would like try to somehow connect it to something that it just happened to pop onto their television that day. And I said, look, I am not that petty and small-minded. I've kind of zoom out from the world and look at, you know, things over a grander scale. And that's really where I get kind of my inspiration from. And noir is also about something, a very abstract process that artists use in the 1800s. However, there's another album that I want to work on. I have an album finished, pretty much ready to just sit down at the studio desk and go, right, we need to slap some vocals on this. We need to twiddle it up and da 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 da. I've got a ton of material. So basically just leave me locked in for the next year. Unfortunately, I will not be able to do that because at the end of March, when I've finished, hopefully all the arrangements for the orchestral album, I'll be back in the US for shows. We'll be starting all the shows that had to be postponed because of shortages of everything, because every single band and its mother has been out on tour or had already pre-booked their buses, their lights, everything last year. And so when we got around to this in March, we were asking bus companies, got a bus? Have anybody got a bus? And they're like, nope, we're all booked out. And we could not physically do the tour without it. We would have to drag the equipment behind us. And I can't expect new crew to be driving in a van, getting no sleep for 5 days on a professional tour. Right. And expect them to love me after 2 days. They don't know me and they're not going to do that. So we ended up having to postpone because of shortages of literally everything. Crew were bailing out and saying, sorry, man, I'm booked on another tour. They do a retainer with me, all this kind of stuff. So in the end, it was like moving objects. It was an impossible situation. And I said, look, at this point, I'm not going to wait until the last day to postpone. Let's just bite the bullet now, get it done. We'll do it next year. Hopefully everything will be better. It will be.
Yeah.
So we're going to do all those shows next year. So that starts in Tampa, goes all the way up the East Coast and wanders into like Montreal and Toronto, and then starts wandering. And nobody asked this. Why are you playing Sick New World at the end of April and your shows end somewhere in early April? And they go, it's almost as if people think we're going to fly home and then fly back to Vegas. Not a chance. So we'll be on tour. We got a lot of places to play, a lot of places we didn't get to play. And on this run just now, I had a really severe allergic reaction just before we played the gig in Denver. So after the gig in Minneapolis, I had to go to an emergency doctor who did all kinds of tests and everything and said, goodness, you're lying down for 3 days and you're not moving before you even attempt to walk on a stage again. So yeah, that kind of puts a dent in your life.
Yeah.
And then that meant that the Denver show and the Salt Lake City show had to be postponed. So we'll be back to take care of all that. We've worked out a really nice schedule. We've got it. So, excuse me, pardon me. I apologize. Yeah,
you're okay. I'll make sure to post, you know, links and pictures when we release the interview to all of us. I know one of them I was talking to right before we started the interview here. My dear friend, Jason Corbett of Actors, is very, very excited to be doing a show with you.
We're playing with Actors in Mexico City on Halloween this year. And I'm really excited about it because I love Actors. I mean, maybe people have started to notice the bands I bring along on tour. You know, I had Holy Graham, had Traitors. This is a huge passion for me.
Yeah.
I love bands like that. I had a whole list of bands that were like my wish to bring bands like this. I tell you what, if I did the next tour, I'd love to bring someone like Straight Razor, something like that.
Yeah.
Just some like hard Gazapelstein-esque electro, and Omar's awesome. So there's a lot of like really cool artists. There's artists in Europe that people here have never heard of, that don't even belong in this genre and yet are making music that would slay the dance floor.
I love it. This has been so much fun. Thank you so much, Ronan, for taking time with us and talking about all this. I'll tell you what, until I did this interview, I found that a lot of kind of the philosophy and things that you talked about going on really hit personal to me. It was really wonderful to hear you and talk about this. Everybody needs to go out and check out this tour, the new album coming out. And from all of us here at Sounds and Shows, the last thing that we like to do is spin out to one of your songs for people to hear off the newest record here. What's a song that if people are going to hear and absorb you for the first time, what is a song that you'd like to share and spin out to?
Assuming your audience, I would say Sunflare.
Perfect, perfect. So from all of us here at Sounds and Shadows, this has been the interview here with VNV Nation, and we are going to be spinning out the song Sunflare. For all of you out in interweb land, keep it dark, yo.
words nor hunger.